This is mercy unreserved through your sacrifice so great. I have peace that's undeserved, for the battle has been won, and I fear no shame or loss. Now the sting of death is gone. You're my solid rock and my salvation, my steadfast hope that won't be shaken. My soul will wait, my soul.
just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch. I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch. My eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that I can't. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. And just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open. This time. The power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe. The bright.
Amen, church. Please be seated. Well, church, this morning we are so glad that you're with us. I am overjoyed to be with the people of God together again, singing the praises and proclaiming the wonders of our God and what he is doing in our midst. My name is Matt Archibald, and I am the worship pastor here at Community Church. And if this is your first time with us, we are so glad you're with us. We're better because you're here this morning. Connect with us after the service. Find someone with a silver name tag on. Introduce yourself, or maybe they'll find you. And we want to get to know your story and plug you into what's happening here at Community Church online congregation. If you're joining us this morning, we're blessed because you've joined us for tuning in. Thanks for being with us as well. Well, church, this morning we have a reason to celebrate. We had a very exciting week here at Community Church. We want to let you know a couple things that are happening. As we mentioned last Sunday, we have a block party happening next Sunday. If you're going to want to, you're going to want to come back for that. We've got some food trucks that are going to be out there, some inflatables, and a way to celebrate the entire summer as we kind of go into fall and kick off some of our fall programming. It's just a big collaboration. We just love being together and eating together as a church and just hanging out. So next Sunday, you're going to want to join us for that after our second service right out there in the parking lot. And mentioning some of this programming, starting on Wednesday nights, again on August 10th, is going to be the relaunch of some of our fall programming. If you've been a part of a small group, there are classes that are offered on Wednesday nights, as well as kids programming. That's going to be launching on August 10th. And this year, we're starting from 6 to 7:30. In the past, it's been 6:30 to 8. We've shifted it back by a half hour this year just to accommodate some of our kids a little bit better and some of our families that are a part of that. So that's starting on August 10th. And speaking of some of this programming, I want to invite up Jess Holliday, Carissa Cunningham, and TJ Noland, who comprise our family ministry team. Yeah, absolutely. So they have each had in their individual ministries just some really exciting weeks recently. And so we wanted to have an opportunity this morning for you to be able to see some pictures, to be able to hear some stories of what their weeks have been like. And so TJ, Jess, Carissa, thanks for being with us. I'm going to ask you some questions just to get a feel for what were your weeks like. So Carissa just led kids camp this last week. Jess led a week of middle school ministry activities during the week. And just a few weeks ago, we had a chance to celebrate high school camp. You got a chance to see some of that on a video if you were with us. And so tell us each, give us a gist of your week this last week and high school camp a few weeks ago, and give us a glimpse of what was that week like for you all.
Sure. So kids camp, when kids signed up, they had an opportunity to register for an interest-specific squad. So when they showed up at camp, we had about 45 minutes of being all together, doing corporate worship, having Bible time, and then they went into their squad time. So we had Animalosity, which was all about animals, Crazeroo, which was our littlest kids at camp, and they were just doing rotations of different activities. We had Game On, which were doing all kinds of sports. And then our outdoor adventures group was doing, yeah, and we had Max Magoo.
Who's that?
Right?
Crazy.
So we had our outdoors adventures group that was fishing, setting up a campsite, doing all kinds of outdoorsy type things.
Yeah, so for middle school, we had a chance just to connect. We got to worship together, play some games together, and our theme for the week was game changers. As they're getting ready to jump into a new school year, we just kind of talked about what are those game-changing moments in your faith that move it from where it is to where it can be. And so just leaned into that as a team and just had a great time getting to know each other and building community.
Yeah, and then a few weeks ago, actually almost about a month ago, we had our high school camp, and every year we go up to a beautiful camp in northern Wisconsin called Silver Birch Ranch. And this year, it was a blessing for myself of being able to be the chapel speaker this year, and not only to be able to share and open up scripture with our students, but also the 300 other students that were there. And that week of that summer is so pivotal and incredible for our students of seeing them grow with each other, but then also within their groups. It's a blessing and awesomeness just to, awesomeness is a word, right?
Yeah.
It is in student ministry. Yeah, it is. But of seeing them bond with one another, it's beautiful to see it.
So, church, one of the things that we are talking about a lot during this entire series of what is the good life is this idea that the good life is the one that is lived in community. And so from the three of you, in this last week of kids camp, middle school, and then high school camp, what does it look like for you to have experienced some of that community, and what in particular of what you did showed you some of the community of this church, but also just some of the community displayed in the ministries?
Yeah, so people showed up in a big way. It was amazing to see some of our leaders, some people who are seasoned and have been volunteering here long before my few months here, and some that this was their first service opportunity, and they rocked it. So seeing our people come in and invest in the lives of our kids was amazing. Those who couldn't be here, I had several who came up to me before camp and offered scholarships for kids, offered for ways to pay for this week to be possible for the kids. So even the ones who weren't here were making a huge impact.
For middle school, it was just them getting to build relationships with each other and build community that way, but also just watching some of our high school students who used to sit in the same seats they are come in and walk alongside them and even lead worship for them was just incredible to watch.
And then One of the awesome things we saw at high school camp this year, it was when our high school students were the first movers with each other. That when they would see a peer moved or struggling or just having conversation or something during chapel or during worship or during group time throughout the week, they were the first movers, going to them, putting their arms around them, praying with them, praying for them, which is just incredible and awesome to see.
And finally, if you can think of any stories or one story in particular that stands out to you from your weeks of what you were involved in, is there anything that sticks out to you as a particular story of that really captured what you feel like it was all about?
Sure. So I can't pick just one, but I'll share a few very quickly. So a couple of my campers who had never met each other before this week, and even halfway through the week, were running out the doors, hugging each other in the parking lot, telling them that they'd see them tomorrow, and just that connection that was built between the kids. Every single time I saw it made me want to cry, because that's what the week is all about, is that relationship building. Those relationships between the kids, between the leaders and the kids, was amazing. Jason came and he interacted with all the different groups, and you've probably seen the picture already of him blindfolded. He was playing clothespin samurai with the kids, and he challenged them that anybody who could get a clothespin would get a free donut this morning, so he's forking out lots of donuts. But just being able to see our kids connect with our lead pastor in that way, that, you know, they come to church and that's not just the man who speaks up front, but that's the man who plays with them, is huge. And, you know, our week ended in tears from some of our campers in the most beautiful way, because they just didn't want this time to be over. And, you know, my prayer is that that will follow us into our Sunday mornings, and these kids will come in and be able to see their new best friends and get to spend their time loving Jesus together.
I think for middle school, a couple of the wins were watching them, some of them not know each other's names at the beginning of the week, but looking for each other each day, seeing if that person's coming in and really building that relationship. And for me, it was my third week here, and so I didn't know their names. And so getting to know them and build those relationships, and, you know, four of the little girls took a Polaroid picture, and it is now the only picture in my office because I haven't settled in yet. And so just really sweet and really working on building those relationships together.
And I think it's difficult to be able to describe it, but one of the things I saw this year, and I see it every year, but especially this last year, is the students taking the focus of the week being on Jesus and having that be the focus for themselves. So seeing all of our high school students, whether it was from memorizing scripture and then coming to different leaders and us jumping on our radios to say, hey, make sure you write this down for this student, they really this year took that step to saying, God, I want you to be the focus. I want you to be the focus not only of this week, but then also when I go back home. So that was, for many, many students, that was the case.
Awesome. Church, will you show your appreciation for TJ and Chris and Jess? Well, church, one of the things we love to do, wait, don't go anywhere yet, don't go anywhere, stay. One of the things we love to do as a congregation is we pray for our leaders. We pray for people in this church. We are a praying church. And so if you would join me this morning, we don't necessarily need to all come up here and lay hands on them, but just by symbol, if you would just extend your hand out, I'm going to pray for them. You pray with me, and let's pray for our family ministry team and for the ministry that they've been able to do this last week. God, we are so grateful to be called to your service, both those on the stage and those you've called in the congregation to be a part of building your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. We're just so grateful for TJ and Jess and Carissa, who have committed themselves to seeing our kids and our middle schoolers and our students discipled and brought up well. So thank you for their commitment to that. And I pray that you would restore rest to them, even in this next week, just this last week of a lot of hard work, and for the relationships and the community that has been formed now from these individual ministries. I pray that you would bless and continue to build the partnerships that have happened for the leaders and the kids and the students both. Thank you for bringing them to us. Thank you for the ministry that took place. We pray your blessing over these three leaders. And the church said together, amen. Well, church, let's stand together again this morning, and we're going to continue in song.
Oh, I'm leaning on your everlasting arm.
The morning sun and mercies new to the evening stars. Every promise is true. As I walk this world, I'm held by you. I am leaning on your everlasting arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, what a priceless gift that I'm yours, you are mine. Let my restless soul be still and know I am leaning on your everlasting arms.
The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth.
The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth. The more I'm leaning, the more I'm flying, feels less like dying, more like living for heaven on earth. For heaven on earth.
Amen, church. Please be seated once again. Well, church, this morning, as we just celebrated the family ministry that happened this last week for our family ministry team, just a few weeks ago, if you were with us, we prayed for and we sent off Susanna Self and Vicky Jordal, who have joined us this morning after some time serving in Brazil over the last over a week and a half. Just a couple weeks ago, they came back. And so we wanted you to also have an opportunity to hear what ministry was like while they served in Brazil for a week and a half. So Susanna and Vicky, thanks for being with us. If you were here just a moment ago, I asked some questions of our family ministry team, and I want to get the same kind of feel from you. We got some pictures that are going to scroll. You'll be able to see a little bit of what the time in Brazil was looking like. But if you can share, what was the gist of kind of what you all did in Brazil? Give us a glimpse of kind of your week and a half being down there.
Well, first off, we do send greetings from Brazil. They all love everybody. we did an English camp, the first part, with over 200 kids. And then in the middle of that, we had a tea with the women. It was the first kind of event they've had since COVID. And we had 80 people sign up, and 140 showed up. So.
Amen.
And this picture is Ricardo, and you can see the former CCG emblem there. So it is kind of neat to see that in another country. And then his shirt is wet because it rained on us every day. We were either going in or out of it. And I did want to talk about Nolina?
Sure.
Okay. mention one of our team members there. That's our team. She is 71 years old. She's been wanting to go on a mission trip since she was 5, and this was her first mission trip. So no matter the age, what your situation is, you can go on a mission trip.
Yeah, awesome.
As we're called to go overseas, not everybody can go immediately, but if you make plans and if God's tugging on your heart, I went this year, and I'm over 30 now. And so you too can do it. her little granddaughter says, you can do it. So you can do it. We do bring those greetings because they're a community church just like we are. And they're the church plant that our church is supporting. So be praying for Feta Nova. It just means New Market. And they started with children. Now, not everybody would plant a church with 53 children. But they're pretty important, aren't they? If they're your kids and your grandkids. Mm. And we're up to 7 adults. That's not very good, is it? If you want to plant a whole church. But the word is vision. That pastor has vision, like coming out the wazoo. They really believe that God's at work, and they walk in that vision. And these are the kids that are at that church. And you can see it's a clean church, it's orderly. But there's one part about it, and the picture will scroll in just a minute, that shows you an empty room that is no more finished than anything. There you go. And it looks like it's not finished. You can see sunlight out it. What on earth would they need that? They have a vision. They want to offer Bible classes. They want to offer school tutoring. They want to offer places for women to meet. And as Susanna mentioned, our tea with all those women, it just shows the hunger to be together in community, but also hunger for the Lord. And so that's what your church, my church, our church, helped. That was one of the projects that we helped with there, financially and in person. We took 80 bags, and we thought, well, we've got these extra 20. We might as well fill them. You know, somebody will use it. And then 140 showed up. So that's to your tea.
Talk about, you just mentioned something about the community, what the community is like. Share with us, what does it look like for that church in particular and your time there? What does it look like for the community to come together, and how did you see community manifesting itself while you were there?
They just really loved us as soon as we got there. They just really loved on us and immediately made us part of their community. Just because we're from America, you know, that's kind of a novelty for them. But they also are just a very loving people, and they do start with the kids, and that kind of brings in the families and brings in the moms and the dads. So focusing on that just kind of helped build that community.
And it's just like what we're doing. We have children's camp, but that's not the only thing we're doing. Well, it's not the only thing they want to do, too. And so really they're not much different than us. They need each other. And we learned a new song, and I don't sing at all. Matt will be very thankful I don't. But it says, I need you. You need me. We need Christ until the end. But they don't stop there. When they say until the very end, they go, woohoo! Go woohoo with me. Woohoo! Because if we're in Christ, the end has no scare for us. Well, they know that too. But with Christ, what if they didn't have Jesus? And that's our goal, is to be a place where people learn about Christ at Community Church of Greenwood, Community Church of Feta Nova at the New Market.
Well, church, again, will you show your appreciation for Vicki and Susanna? And as Vicki just said, as being a part of community church, one of the things that we do here is we do give offerings. And when you give to Community Church of Greenwood, this is part of what happens, is we're able to send out and bless places around the world. We're able to join in partnership with what God's church is doing in Brazil, here at this church, in Greenwood, and beyond. And we get to be a part of partnering with the gospel and seeing the kingdom of God and the reality of the kingdom being established here on earth as it is in heaven. And so we're going to pray for that. We're going to pray as we receive this morning. If you've come ready to give, there are envelopes and seats next to you. We have boxes outside of our sanctuary. You can drop those off. You may also give online. But as a part of this church, we go and say, Jesus, we support you. We believe your mission is at work. And we believe, Jesus, you are doing far more than we could ever imagine. And what a way to hear some of the stories of how Jesus is moving both in our community and in the world around us. So will you pray this morning for them and then also as we receive this morning's offering. God, thank you for calling Vicky and Susanna for a moment like this. Thank you for the ministry that you are doing in Brazil and Feira Nova. Thank you for them responding to your call, for them responding to your passion, to your love, for the work that has already been going on and continues. Thank you for calling your church to rise up. And thank you for allowing us to be a part of that mission. Even though we didn't all go to Brazil, we know and we sent and we are a part of this entire thing. So thank you for calling your people, your church, to give and to love and to partner with in this mission for your kingdom here on earth. And so thank you for the celebration of ministry, and thank you for bringing these women in leadership like this. And we pray this in Christ's name. And the church said together, amen. Well, church, let's stand together again. And we're going to sing about this greatness of our God, that this God who gives us life and love, that he gives us the breath in our lungs. He is a great Lord. So let's sing this together. You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is
your breath.
sing it's your prayer. It's your prayer.
My name is Jason, one of the pastors here at Community Church, and wherever you are in your walk, I am thrilled that you're here this morning. Well, I want to introduce you to Craig Westrick. Craig comes representing Summit Ministries, and he's going to talk about an exciting event that we have, but Craig and I have walked a lot of miles together. How long have we actually known each other?
Well, that goes back to high school.
Yes.
So
We got some gray.
We don't need to say how long that is, but it's more than 30 plus years. So,
yeah. And good night. We're neighbors. His kids were little and prayed us into that house. We looked at one house, and that's where we ended up. And then I remember one day my kids were riding some contraption down your hill and ran over one of your kids, and we got the house anyway, which was a beautiful thing. So, somehow, in the chaos of the court, I don't think we've burned anything to the ground.
No, but it was close.
It's been close. It's been close a few times. So, and you, how long have you been a part of this church?
That actually goes into the 40 years, so that would be 43.
All right.
So you're almost grown up here.
Almost
doors open. We came.
An OG here, right? You've been here forever and have been in leadership and all kinds of just been a real gift to our church. So I just want to say personally, thank you for what you've done for our church. And I mean, it's so we just so appreciate you. And oh my goodness, I could tell lots of stories, but that clock's ticking and we've got an event
the opposite way
to talk about. So there's this thing called Summit Ministry. Tell us a little bit about that and what event we've got coming.
Yeah, we've got a high impact event, Clay, if you want to put that up there, coming. Some of you may know of Summit Ministries. Summit Ministries is out of Colorado Springs, Colorado, and they have for over 50 years run two-week intensive training camps for 15 to 30-year-old young adults. So you can imagine, they do 10 camps, two-week camps, every summer, been doing it for 50 years. And in those camps, they do a deep dive into biblical truth and how it applies to all the issues facing our culture at that time. And so what's happening right now that you'll see up here, Rooted Summit, is through the pandemic, they made a decision strategically to condense that and bring it to communities rather than to invite people out. So we have a 24-hour event coming up with Summit Ministries with three of their key speakers that they're bringing here to dig into how biblical truth applies to current critical aspects. And you'll see them here. Clay has it up. So we've got Jeff Myers, who's the president. And then some of you may know Christopher Yuan and his ministry around holy sexuality. Those three speakers are coming on a Friday evening, September 9th, and then September 10th, the morning Saturday. And we'll be digging into these three topics in this high impact opportunity. So there were five leaders in our community from, five different churches, leaders, and two different schools gathered together, knew of this opportunity that Summit was making available and said, we want to bring it to the south side of Indianapolis. Our community needs it. And I think we all just experienced why our community needs that over the last week, right? Mm-hmm. We need deep biblical truth applied into how we think, how we feel, and how we act in our community. So that's the opportunity that's before us.
So we've got churches actually working together.
We do.
That's a good thing. Amen?
Yep.
So who can come to this?
So I would say 15 to 95, if you will. The target audience is really high school, young adults, young marrieds. But the encouragement would be, if you're like me, these are hard conversations to have with your children or young people in your life, invite them and come. So we already have people registered that are up in their 70s and 80s. So that's the target. But if you have an interest or a desire or a need to dig deep into how God's truth applies to critical cultural issues today, this is the spark opportunity for us. So you're welcome. Under 15, probably not, but over 15, so think high school and up.
Yeah, so what do you hope to get out of this? What's the desired outcome?
So I think our goal really is to take this emerging generation and connect them together. If you will, Jason, it's the good life we've been talking about. How do we get below the shallow answers and simple community that's not rooted in the gospel? How do we bring that and offer that to this community to connect them? Right, and give them the opportunity to build safety in that community, not just because they're friends, but because they're rooted, if you will, in the gospel. It's a good life. That's what you've been preaching exhorting us.
Yeah. So what do we do? How do we sign up? How can people help?
So there's a QR code, Clay, if you want to put that up there. If you want to scan that QR code, it takes you to the website. It actually takes you to the registration part of the website. You can click on the home button page or the home button there, and it'll take you to the details of that. Maria and I, you'll see her sitting over here inconspicuously with her Rooted Summit t-shirt on, will be out in the back. We've also arranged a discount code for all CCG members and anybody you would like to invite to be able to register for $20 versus the conference cost of $60. And so you can see us out back and we'll be delighted to chat with you. We've got information and flyers. And so you could sign up today if you want. We've got t-shirts as well. And so come on out, talk to us. We'd love to engage with you. Thank you.
Thanks, Craig. Would you pray for us?
I'd be glad to. Lord Jesus, your truth is what we're after. I'm simply grateful to you for the impact of your church here, this body, the people that you've used to engage my heart and my mind and my feelings with that truth, not in a shallow way, but in a deep way. And Lord, I want to lift up to you our community in this moment, that as we come together and grieve the loss of people that you've created that bear your image, Father, that you would teach us how to grieve together in such a way that we would receive your comfort, be drawn together, be strengthened, and be able to confront the challenges in our community, in our culture, with your truth in a loving way that shines your light brightly and invites people to become co-laborers in your kingdom. It gives them the life that's truly life. So, Father, I pray that you would offer that encouragement to Jason now as he preaches, that it would open our hearts and it would bring you honor and glory. And I lift it up to you in the name of Jesus, who alone makes it possible for us. Amen.
Amen. Thanks. Well, in case you haven't caught the theme this morning, the better the way to the good life is found in a community. A community. A community who sees and shares the hope of Jesus together. That's what we're about as a church. That's what we're about as a church. Now, my question for you this morning, as you think about this week, it's been a hard week. It's been a really hard week. It's been a hard week for our community. I mean, I remember when the Greenwood Mall was not the Greenwood Mall. I remember walking on the wooden sidewalks, the temporary sidewalks. I remember when it first got enclosed. I remember getting, I don't know how many hundreds of pieces of Luca pizza at that food court. And to know what went on a week ago breaks my heart. Just breaks my heart. And at the same time, as we are in a world that seems increasingly challenging, we have so much opportunity. So much opportunity to see and share the hope of Jesus together. So our text this morning, we're going to dive in and we're going to look fairly briefly at what it means to be salt and light in this world. And those are real churchy words, but I want to just ask it to you this way. Are you an influencer? Are you an influencer in our culture today? In the world that you're in the circles that you're in, are you an influencer? And what are you influencing for? We spent the last 3 weeks diving into this description of what it means to be a part of God's kingdom, what that looks like. Last week, we left with this idea of blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And then to walk out of here and see that peace come crashing down. So our focus this morning is, how do we influence? What's that influence look like? And part of what is so unique and so riveting about Jesus' teachings is that it starts with who you are. And if we look at Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, I mean, we can come up with this core truth that who you are comes before what you do. Who you are comes before what you do. And what you do reveals who you are. So what is your influence? Are you the type of person? Are we the type of people as a community? One of the countercultural teachings of Jesus is that it's not just about you. It's not just about me. It's about us. There is a we to our community. But are we the type of church? Are you the type of person? Are you the type of family that naturally has influence for Jesus? Now, let me take you to Matthew 5:13, and we'll dive in and see what Jesus has to teach us this morning. Jesus says this: you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Jesus gives us two word pictures, two metaphors that describe our influence in our world. First, he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. Well, what did that mean, first of all, to Jesus' audience? If you're watching your diet, you may hear that and say, salt's a bad thing. I like too much of it. I got to get rid of that in my diet. But what did salt mean to Jesus' audience? Well, really, two things. Salt was used to preserve. We don't do that so much anymore. And it was used to flavor. I want to talk briefly about those. First of all, salt preserves. Salt preserves. So what is the natural process of meat if you don't refrigerate it? It gets rotten, it breaks down, and it stinks. What happens to a culture without the love and the hope of Jesus? It gets rotten, it breaks down, and it can stink. That's a real complicated message for you this morning. Are you and I, are we an agent, are we an influencer that preserves our world? Or do we just become something that allows everything else to break down? Are you a preservative against the decay? Now, in Jesus' day, there were a different culture, but you had basically Pharisees and teachers of the law, and their problem, according to Jesus, was hypocrisy. their words and their actions didn't match. We're going to get into that next week a little bit about the matters of the heart and the moral code and all that. But there were also the Romans who were just flat out brutal. It was all about power. Jesus would expose the rottenness of both of those cultures and say, against that, Jesus offers something different. So does your love stand out? Not just your intentions, but love that shows up on your calendar or in your bank account. I was so proud of our church this past week with our kids and our students, and I think back and I see these shirts and I see people who have given up their time, their precious time to be valuable to pour into the next generation. Anybody concerned about the next generation? About what? We need to fight against the tide, right? With the love of Jesus. And that takes time. That takes eyeball to eyeball, shoulder to shoulder. We're going to get on the floor with kids and we're going to give them a picture of church, a picture of Jesus that is beautiful, that they want to be a part of. That matters. So let me say thank you to all that have had any part in that. Salt also flavors. Salt flavors. Now, our influence, our flavor, again, is a reflection of who we are. And there's a lot of directions we could go with that flavor, but I want to take you to this. Your influence is an indicator of your identity. If we're not flavoring the culture around us, why? Why? And again, this is not so much a personal you, this is a you all, this is a we. Why is that? What keeps us from providing flavor? What keeps us from just being bland? If Jesus isn't changing you, why would you share it? That's the reality. If Jesus isn't really changing us, why would anybody else pay attention to that? That's the tough part. The great opportunity, though, is to share that influence. It was interesting to me thinking back through this message and the Apostle Paul as he preaches. I want to take you to Ephesians 3:8. He says this, "To me, the very least of all saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles, the non-Jews, the unfathomable riches of Christ." This word, unfathomable. Do you see the riches of Christ as unfathomable? You know what a fathom is? It's 6 feet. It is a unit of measurement. That means you cannot exhaust the depth of the love and riches of Christ. One of the joys, we got to fish with the kids this week out in the retention pond. You know how deep that retention pond is? It's about 10 feet. It's about a fathom and a half. It was kind of fun, but it's nothing like going deep sea fishing. Some of us, we just get stuck in the retention pond, I'm afraid. And we need to go deeper. Craig talked about the shallows. We need to go into the depths of the riches of Christ. So let me ask you this morning, do you bring the flavor of Jesus to a bland world, or do you bring the flavor of the world to a bland walk with Jesus? Which way does that go for you? You know, I got adult kids, and this is what I pray for my kids. I pray that Jesus is more exciting than anything else they have. I don't care how much money they make. I don't care how beautiful of trips they take and all those things. But is Jesus the most exciting, adventurous part of their lives? Was blessed last Saturday, difficult circumstance, but Brad, our wonderful exec pastor, lost his grandfather suddenly to a heart attack, 85 years old. And Brad had really honored his grandfather and preached the funeral. And one of the, just really touched me because it gave me a vision of grandparenting that was just really cool. Another dimension of that. And his grandfather loved Notre Dame football, loved the Cubs, loved ice cream, loved birds, loved snacks. All the grandkids talked about that. But you know what he loved above all else? Jesus Christ. And that was at the center, that was at the core, and that testimony was universal. I've been to lots of funerals. I know when things get kind of embellished a little bit and when things are real. This was the real deal. This was the real deal. That's a life of influence. Now, very quickly, you are the light of the world. I grew up in church and Sunday school, and this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. I asked Matt if he could sing it. He vetoed it. We're all grateful for that. But does your light shine? What does that look like? We got a culture right now that looks out at the church and looks out at Jesus and I think is confused. I think there's a beautiful picture of Jesus, a beautiful picture of the kingdom, a beautiful picture of the church that our culture sometimes misses. We forget sometimes how truly revolutionary and countercultural the message of Jesus was. You know, as we think about, you know, we've tried to paint a little bit of a picture of kids and men and women and different places of serving, different ages, all, you know, it's a beautiful picture. I love what Paul says in Galatians 3, 27, 28. He says, "So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." There's a message that we take for granted sometimes that was so countercultural to anything that was available in Jesus' day. We ought to lean into that vision and make that more clear. John 8:12, Jesus spoke to the people and he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Jesus didn't just like spout poetry from the mountaintop. He was in the thick of it with people. And as he said this, you know, there were crowds that flocked to him, but there are also people who challenged him. When he said these words, you know what they said to Jesus? "Hey, who's your daddy? Who's your father? On what authority do you make this claim to be the light of the world?" What a claim. What a claim. That's not a claim that deserves a moderate response. We got to be all in, or we got to say this is nuts. Now, Jesus rose from the dead to prove that it was true. That's what he did. Now, light does two things that I want to focus on. First of all, light reveals. Light reveals. What does light reveal? It reveals the truth. Had an opportunity this past Friday for a community prayer vigil, and it was a great opportunity, and it was great to bring the community together and pray. And on the platform, we had everything from a rabbi to a Catholic priest to different denominations of the Protestant church to Islam and Buddhism. I mean, it was a big stage, a big platform. So at one level, we can say yes, we can unite and we can love our community, but at the same time, there is an exclusivity to the claims of Jesus. There is an exclusivity. So when I pray, I'm going to pray in the name of Jesus. the name above all names. And the resurrection is true. So we can be kind, we can be winsome, we can be all those things, but we ought not back away from the fundamental truth of who Jesus is and what his word says. Light also directs. Jesus says, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." How do you see Jesus? There's a light that is revealed, the truth. We don't apologize for that. We don't back down from that. At the same time, how do others see you, and what do they see in you? What do they see in us? Jesus is clear. They ought to see our love. They ought to see our good deeds. And what do those good deeds do? They direct our vision to the Father. That's what the light does. So what is in between for you? What keeps people from seeing that light? Three quick action steps for you. Three what nows. First one is simple. Take a step of learning with someone who has a different perspective than you. Maybe it's age, maybe it's disagreement on politics, whatever those differences may be, but take a step of learning and listen to one another. Two, take a greater step of vulnerability. Part of the charge against the church sometimes, oh, they're just a bunch of hypocrites. When we portray an image that's not true, that charge can stick. May we share what's really going on in our lives. And finally, invite someone outside the church to take a step towards our church community. We have a beautiful community. We have a lot to offer. Would you take that step and invite somebody to something? And that could start with, hey, come over for dinner at my house. And let's build a relationship and let's take a step towards the community. A better way to the good life is to share the hope of Jesus together as a community. Now, as a community, as those who put their faith and their trust in Christ, one of the ways that we remember that is we come to the communion table together. And I want you to think about the cross for just a minute. What did the cross mean back at the time of this teaching? You know what the cross represented? The cross was the most brutal instrument of execution. And it represented the power and authority of Rome. And think how in a couple of decades that cross was transformed into the greatest representation of love that the world has ever seen. And this morning, as we come to the table together, as those who put their faith and trust in Christ, we remember that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his disciples in the upper room, and after giving thanks, he broke the bread and he gave it to them, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." So may we receive the bread together. And in the same way, Jesus took the cup. He says, "This cup represents my blood, the blood of the new covenant, blood shed for the forgiveness of sins." So just as we receive the bread, may we now receive the cup together. Would you pray with me? Father, we come to you this morning thankful for the picture of your kingdom, thankful for the opportunity to be a part of your community, your family. And Lord, we ask now that your Spirit would work in us to transform us so that we can be salt, we can be light, we can help bring about preservation, we can bring freedom, we can bring truth and love to a community who desperately needs it. And may we do it together. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Church, let's stand together again as you're able. And let's close this morning as we sing together.
I count on one day, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Yes, I will.
Good it is to look back and celebrate the work that God is doing and to look forward to what he's going to do. I want to leave you with this blessing from God's word. God said, God did not give you a spirit of fear. He did not give you a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and self-control. And may you go knowing that you have the Holy Spirit to guide you, to lead you, and may we do it together as we share the hope of Jesus to a community that desperately needs it. Amen. Go in peace. See me for a prayer card on your way out.
And I choose to pray.